Thank you, Jim. Thank you, New Hampshire. That might have been the best intro I've ever had. I have to bring Jim with me everywhere. I want to thank in particular the college students who are here today because I do not remember a class starting at 8 a.m. So Jim gave a fantastic intro, but he missed the best part. How many of you know I went to high school here in New Hampshire? How'd you miss this, Jim? I went to Phillips Exeter Academy, graduated in 1992. And they just brought me back to speak a few months ago. And when I was there, I said, I haven't been back since graduation because I didn't really have a good time here. And the student body then erupted in applause, which was not what I'd expected. I looked around, I was like, oh, I sort of feel bad that that's the reaction. So after I graduated from Exeter, I went to Brown University, not that far from here. I didn't know what to do, so I went to law school. I sense there's some lawyers here in the room. I can tell by the ties. I was an attorney for 5 unhappy months, and then I left to start a company. How many of you have started a business or organization or a mailing list or a club? So if you have your hand up, you know two things. Number one, you know it's much harder than it looks. And number two, when someone asks you how it's going, what do you say? It's going great. And my business also went great until it failed. So I was a struggling entrepreneur. I still owed 6 figures in educational loans. My parents told their friends I was a lawyer because it was an easier story. But I worked in startups for another 10 years. I became the head of an education company that grew to become number one in the United States and was acquired by a bigger company, a public company, in 2009. Now, 2009 was a very hard time in much of the country. How was it here in New Hampshire? It's hard to believe the financial crisis is now 11 years ago. And it racked so many, devastated communities around the country. And I thought I had some insight as to why the financial crisis had unfolded. It had unfolded in large part because all of the wannabe whiz kids I'd gone to Exeter, Brown, and Columbia with, many of them had gone to Wall Street and designed exotic financial instruments, derivatives, mortgage-backed securities that had crashed the economy. So I thought, well, that's a train wreck. We should do something about that. And so I thought, well, what would I want our enterprising, ambitious college graduates to do in an ideal world? And the vision I came up with was starting businesses and creating jobs in places like Detroit, Cleveland, St. Louis, Baltimore, New Orleans, and cities around the country. So I quit my job, I started an organization called Venture for America, and I started calling rich friends with this question: do you love America? Then the smart among them said, what does it mean if I say yes to this question? And I said, at least $10,000. So 12 of them said, I love America for $10,000. It's like, I thought you did. So it raised a few hundred thousand dollars, grew into the millions, helped create several thousand jobs around the country, was honored by the Obama administration, as Jim said. So I got to bring my wife to meet the president. My in-laws were very excited about me for about a week. So I was getting all these accolades and awards for creating jobs around the country, but I had this sinking feeling, in part because of my travels. How many of you grew up here in New England? I sense a bunch of you. Yes. How about the Midwest? The South? West Coast. I grew up in upstate New York and then came of age here in New England. So those of you who had your hands up of New England, I grew up in similar environments. And I was blown away by the disparities between St. Louis and San Francisco or Michigan and Manhattan, where if you fly a few time zones, you feel like you're crossing decades or dimensions or ways of life. And I was doing work in these communities for 7 years. And then Donald Trump became our president in 2016. How did you all react when Donald Trump won? If you're here in this room, you probably reacted quite negatively. But I guess I'm assuming that. I guess some of you. I'm thinking, it's like, how democratic is this room? Regardless, we all have friends, family members, neighbors who celebrated that outcome. And if you were to turn on cable news today, you'd get a series of explanations as to why Donald Trump is our president. It would go something like Russia, racism, Facebook, FBI, Hillary Clinton, emails, all mixed together in some kind of stew. But I'm a numbers guy, and when he won, I took this as a giant red flag. I said, we're at a point where tens of millions of our fellow Americans decided that taking a bet on the narcissist reality TV star was the way to go. And here I was, a celebrated entrepreneur who'd created thousands of jobs, with a sinking feeling that every job my organization was creating was like water getting poured into a bathtub that has a giant hole ripped in the bottom, where any job we were generating, we were losing tens or hundreds of jobs. And it had gotten so bad that As Jim said, I believe it led to Donald Trump's election in 2016. The numbers have a very clear explanation as to why he won, that we automated away 4 million manufacturing jobs in Michigan, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Missouri, Iowa, all the states he needed to win and did win. And if you doubt this explanation, there's a straight line up between the adoption of industrial automation and the movement towards Trump in each individual voting area. It's one of the strongest correlations anyone can find in the data. Here in New Hampshire, you all lost 30,000 manufacturing jobs yourselves, though it happened a little bit earlier, but you've seen what's happened in your communities. The fact is, when a manufacturing plant closes and the jobs disappear, blue goes to red. That's happening here in New Hampshire, in the north and other parts of the state too. Now, unfortunately, what happened to manufacturing jobs is now shifting to other parts of our economy. How many of you have noticed stores closing where you work and live here in New Hampshire? Retail stores. And why are those retail stores shutting their doors? One word answer, Amazon. Amazon's like a vacuum sucking up $20 billion in value every single year, causing 30% of America's stores and malls to close for good. How much did Amazon pay in taxes last year? Zero. That is your math, New Hampshire. $20 billion out, zero back. Most common job in most of the country is working as a retail worker or clerk. The average retail worker is a 39-year-old woman making between $9 and $10 an hour. When her store closes, what is her next opportunity going to be? When you all call the customer service line of a big company and you get the software or bot, you probably do the exact same thing I do. You dial 000, say human, 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 until you get someone on the line, right? Raise your hand if that's what you do. Yeah, we all do it. In two or three short years, the software is going to sound like this. Hey, Andrew, how's it going? What can I do for you? It's going to be fast, seamless, delightful. You might not even realize it's software. What is that going to mean for the 2.5 million Americans who work at call centers right now making $14 an hour? I just spoke to a group of 70 CEOs, and I sense there are some CEOs here in this room. I asked the 70 CEOs, how many of you are looking at displacing your back office clerical workers with artificial intelligence and software in the days to come? Guess how many hands went up out of 70? All of them. The truth is, you could fire that CEO if he was not replacing his back office clerical workers with artificial intelligence and software. To me, the biggest challenge is truck driving. How many of you all know a truck driver here in New Hampshire? It's the most common job in 29 states in our country. There are 3.5 million truckers in the United States of America, 94% men, average age 49, average education, high school, or 1 year of college. And my friends in California are working on trucks that can drive themselves. Now, why are they working on these self-driving trucks? For the most American of reasons, for the money. $168 billion a year in estimated cost savings if we can automate trucking. We have robot trucks on the highways right now. UPS is invested in Arizona. So these are the challenges. I'm going to go into self-driving trucks for a minute because to me this is so fundamental. My friends in Silicon Valley tell me they're 98% of the way to self-driving trucks. That sounds very impressive, but 2% is a big problem when we're talking about semi-trucks. You can't have things smashing into, you know, things like, oh, we got a 99% right. I mean, you can't have 1% error rate. And the self-driving trucks are really bad with something called snow that you know pretty well. It's one reason why the robot trucks are getting tested in Arizona, where there's no snow. So how are they going to get the last 2%? You all remember the first time you saw motion video on your phone, like you watch TV on your phone. You said, wow, we can do that now? That is 3G. We are in the process of rolling out 5G around the country. And the way my technologist friends believe that they can get that last 2% is by equipping the trucks with teleoperating software so that if it's in a location that's snowy and the computer doesn't know what to do, the computer alerts a teleoperator sitting in a warehouse in Nevada or Arizona who will then beam into the truck and drive it like a video game because there'll be cameras on the front of the truck so they can just see out of it as if they're sitting there. That is the plan for the last 2%. What do you think the ratio will be between teleoperators in Nevada and Arizona and the 3.5 million Americans who drive a truck right now? 2%? 5%? What's that going to mean for the 3.5 million American truckers or the 7 million Americans who work in truck stops, motels, and diners that rely upon the truckers getting out and having a meal? Donald Trump is not the cause of all of our problems. He is a symptom. He's a manifestation. We're in the third inning of the greatest economic transformation in the history of our country, what experts are calling the fourth industrial revolution. When is the last time you heard a politician say the words fourth industrial revolution? Probably just now. And I am barely a politician. So this is what got me off the bench, where I said, my country does not understand what's happening. We are scapegoating immigrants for problems immigrants have next to nothing to do with. If you go to a factory in the Midwest, you don't find wall-to-wall immigrants, you find wall-to-wall robot arms and machines. And that is what is pushing more and more Americans to the sidelines. My first move in this was not to run for president. I went to DC to our leaders and I said, what are we going to do about the fact that we're going through the fourth industrial revolution and Americans don't understand what's happening? What do you think our leaders in DC said to me when I said, what are we going to do? Come on, put yourself in their shoes. What would a DC lobbyist or policymaker say? That's a good. So number one was, we cannot talk about this. Number two, we should study that further. Number three, we must educate and retrain all Americans for the jobs of the future. And that sounds very responsible. You've probably heard a politician say something very similar. But then I said, look, I took a look at the independent studies evaluating how effective government-funded retraining programs were for the manufacturing workers of the Midwest who lost their jobs. Do you all want to guess how effective those programs were on a percentage basis? 0 to 15%. They're a total dud. If you look at the manufacturing workers who lost their jobs in the Midwest, almost half left the workforce and never worked again. And of that group, half filed for disability. That is how they survived. And then you saw surges in suicides and drug overdoses in those communities to record levels. They became so extreme that our life expectancy as a country has declined for 3 years in a row because deaths of despair have overtaken vehicle deaths for the first time in American history. Do you want to know the last time American life expectancy declined for 3 years in a row? Thank you, Janelle. The Spanish flu of 1918. You have to go back 100 years to a global pandemic that killed millions to find a time in American history where our life expectancy declined for 3 years in a row. We are back there now because of deaths of despair. One person in DC said something to me that brought me here to you all today. He said, Andrew, you're in the wrong town. No one here in DC will do anything about this set of problems because this is not a town of leaders, this is a town of followers. And the only way we will do anything about it is if you create a wave in other parts of the country and bring that wave crashing down on our heads here in DC. I'm so glad I had someone with me because you'd think I was making that up, right? You'd think it's like some kind of movie supervillain speech. It turns out it was a DC lobbyist speech, and they're quite similar. So I said to this, challenge accepted. I'll be back with the wave. This was almost 2 years ago, and here I am. Here I stand before you, fourth, fifth, or sixth in national polls. We just raised $10 million in the last quarter, in increments of only $30 each. So my fans are almost as cheap as Bernie's. But there are a lot of them. And the wave is forming very, very quickly because Americans realize that we have bigger problems than just Donald Trump, and we need a vision that actually helps move America forward in this time of unprecedented change. So what is that vision? If you were here in this room, you probably at some point heard there's an Asian man running for president who wants to give everyone $1,000 a month. And the first time you heard that, you were like, ha ha, that's a gimmick, that will never happen. But this is not my idea. This is a deeply American idea embedded in our history. Thomas Paine was for it at the founding of the country, called it the citizen's dividend. Martin Luther King fought for it in the 60s, called it the guaranteed minimum income for all Americans, and it is what he was fighting for the day he was assassinated in 1968. 1,000 economists, including Milton Friedman, endorsed it in the 60s. It was so mainstream, it passed the US House of Representatives twice under Richard Nixon. It was called the Family Assistance Plan. Came this close to guaranteeing an income floor for all Americans. And then 11 years later, one state passed a dividend where now everyone in that state gets between $1,000 and $2,000 a year, no questions asked. And what state is that? And how does Alaska pay for it? And what is the oil of the 21st century? Data, AI, software, self-driving cars and trucks. How many of you saw the study that said that our data is now worth more than oil? How many of you remember getting your data check in the mail? Where did the data check go? Did it get lost? No, it didn't get lost. It went straight to Facebook, Amazon, Google, and the rest of the trillion-dollar tech companies that are paying zero or near zero in taxes. This is the fundamental challenge that we have, is that the biggest winners of the 21st century economy are not paying back into the system. And we're looking around, asking each other, where's the money going? Where's the money going? That's where the money's going. And they're so powerful that they've managed to confuse everyone as to where the value is heading. It's heading straight into their hands, and they're paying zero or near zero in taxes. This is the problem that we all have to solve. It's up to the voters of New Hampshire. One reason why I love being here, every time I'm here, is that you all are some of the most powerful people in American society. It doesn't feel like it, but just for fun, go ahead and raise your hand and signal how many presidential candidates you've seen in this cycle. So this would be 4, this would be 10, it would be like 12, would be like this. Look at this, so she flashed her hands, it was like 17, 10. And why is that? It's because, do you know how many Californians each New Hampshire voter is worth? About 1,000 Californians each. So you look around this room, there may be 150 New Hampshire voters in this room. That's like 150,000 Californians. That's 4 football stadiums full of Californians. This is one of the only places that democracy actually functions the way it's intended. Most Americans look up and they see the pipes that are just clogged full of money, and there's nothing that we can do about it. And you all can do something about it. That's your power. That's why the presidential candidates like me are coming and presenting our visions for the future to you all, because you can flush the pipes out. Here, your votes actually can change the course of history. That's why I love being here. That's why this is such a magical place. New Hampshire is the place where the future will be built. So what that future looks like, in part, is a dividend for all Americans. And after we pass the dividend and the money flows into your hands, where will the money actually be spent in real life? Like $1,000 a month for you, family members, neighbors. And Chuck Fassi, his family has been getting $1,000 a month from me personally for the last number of months. And he can talk about where they're spending the money, but I want you to ask, how would your friends and neighbors spend $1,000 a month? Groceries? Rent? Daycare? Tuition? How much of it would stay right here in New Hampshire? Most of it. Some of it would float up to the cloud, you like upgrade your Netflix subscription and like buy an extra appliance on Amazon. But most of it would stay right here in New Hampshire. It would go to daycare expenses and car repairs you've been putting off and Little League signups, perhaps political organizations. It would supercharge your Main Street economy, create a trickle-up economy from our people, our families, and our communities up. It would create a sustainable path forward for rural areas in particular, because we know rural areas are getting sucked dry in the 21st century. This is the vision of an economy that you can make real very, very quickly. It's why I love being here. But you can't stop at just laying the foundation. How many of you were excited about GDP when you woke up this morning? Like, I'm going to make a big contribution today. I can feel it. I think we had some bankers in the room who might actually have been excited about GDP. I like to talk about my own family situation. My wife is at home with our 2 boys right now, one of whom is autistic. What is her work included at in GDP every month or every year? 0. And we know that's perverse. We know that her work is among the most challenging and vital in our country today and has immense value. GDP right now is at record highs in the United States. Also at record highs in the United States, stress, financial insecurity, student loan debt, suicides, drug overdoses, mental illness. It's gotten so bad again that GDP and life expectancy are heading in opposite directions. So at this point, you have to ask yourself, are we measuring the right things? Imagine, raise your hand if you run a company or a business or a division. Imagine if you use the wrong measurements for that company or organization or division. How's it going to perform over time? That is where we are right now in the United States. Even the inventor of GDP said this 100 years ago. He said, this is a terrible measurement for national well-being, and we should never use it as that. Think about that. That was 100 years ago. Here we are 100 years later, chasing it off a cliff. Self-driving trucks will be tremendous for GDP, and they'll be very bad for many Americans and many communities. So we have to start measuring the progress in a way that would actually correspond to how we are doing. I'm going to ask you, because I know this is a very smart room, how would you actually measure how your community is doing in a way that would get you excited to wake up in the morning? Mental health and freedom from substance abuse. If I said that got better in New Hampshire, you would jump for joy. Maybe literally. Childhood success rates and educational success. That would make you very happy. How about clean air and clean water? How about income and affordability? Proportion of Americans who retire in quality circumstances, because right now we have millions of Americans who are just going to have to work till the day they die. Inclusion of Americans with disability, both educationally and in the job market. These are the measurements that would actually tell us how we're doing, that would correspond to our progress as a society. And this is how I will update our economic measurements as your president. I will go to the Bureau of Economic Analysis and say, hey, GDP, really old and out of date. Let's modernize it to include childhood success rates and environmental quality and sustainability and our mental health. And then I'll present these real measurements to you all at the State of the Union every year. And then we'll see how we're doing and how we can make progress. It's only by actually identifying the real problems on the ground that we will be able to make progress and also win in 2020. Donald Trump's our president today in large part because he got some of the problems right. He said in 2016, we're going to make America great again. And what did Hillary Clinton respond? America's already great. And that did not work. He got some of the problems right, but his solutions were the opposite of what we need. He said, we're going to build a wall, we're going to turn the clock back, we're going to bring the old jobs back. We have to do the opposite of these things, New Hampshire. We have to turn the clock forward. We have to accelerate our economy and society as quickly as possible. We have to evolve in the way we think about work and value. We have to build a trickle-up economy that will actually work for every American. And I am the ideal candidate for this job because the opposite of Donald Trump is an Asian man who likes math. Thank you all very much. Thank you, appreciate you. Math is an acronym. What does it stand for? Make America think harder, and that's what we're going to do together. That's how we're going to move the country forward in 2020. Thank you all very much.
Questions?
Sure.
Yeah. Oh, yeah,
some questions? Couple minutes.
We have time for a couple of questions, and if you just identify yourself, that would be very helpful, to say the least. If I could just ask the first question, obviously that dividend income is a very, very attractive plan. Anyone over the age of 18, $1,000 a month. I guess the question that someone in Washington would ask, how do you pay for it?
Sure. So you know the old joke, why did I rob the bank? Because that's where the money is. So the question is, where is the money going in America today? You have a $1 trillion tech company like Amazon paying zero in taxes. That's unacceptable. If you give the American people our fair share, a tiny slice of every Amazon sale, every Google search, every Facebook ad, every robot truck mile, you would generate hundreds of billions of dollars in new revenue very, very quickly. This would help pay our data also. This would help pay for the dividend. But the great thing about the dividend and the trickle-up economy is that when the money circulates through our communities, we actually get a lot of that money back. Through economic growth, through more hiring, more activity, we generate hundreds of billions in new tax revenue as a result of bolstering the consumer economy. We save billions on things like incarceration, homelessness services, emergency room healthcare. It was right here in New Hampshire that a corrections officer said to me, we should pay people to stay out of jail because it costs so much when they're in jail. And this is a corrections officer. He knows. We think we're somehow being smart by not spending money on ourselves, our people. We end up paying much more on the back end in much more destructive and punitive ways. There was one study that showed that if we were to invest in our people and alleviate child poverty, we would increase our GDP by $700 billion a year just based on better education and health outcomes. With the dividend, what would you see? You'd see higher graduation rates, higher mental health, better decision making, less domestic violence, lower hospital visits. We would invest in ourselves, our human capital, and it would generate hundreds of billions of dollars, in addition to getting our fair share from the tech companies who are going to be the biggest winners in the 21st century.
Some of the Democratic candidates talk about a wealth tax as a source of income to pay for a lot of these programs. Your thoughts on that?
The wealth tax makes a lot of sense given the nature of our current ultra-extreme winner-take-all economy. But I'm a very data-driven person, and a wealth tax was tried in a host of countries, including Germany, France, Denmark, Sweden, and they all repealed it. They repealed it because it had massive implementation problems and it did not generate nearly the revenue that they thought it would. So to me, we should learn from the experiences of other countries and say, okay, a wealth tax did not work. What does work in other developed countries? And these other developed countries have a mechanism where they get their fair share of every Amazon sale and transactions through a value-added tax. So I think a value-added tax is a much more efficient way to balance our economy than a wealth tax that has not worked out in other nations. Though I'm a fan of the spirit of a wealth tax. It makes sense, but just you have to be practical.
If I could just ask one final question. Congress is debating a major trade bill right now, the United States, Mexico-Canada trade agreement. Your thoughts on that bill being, whether you support it in passing, are your thoughts on trade overall? We've had TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership bill, go down because there wasn't any support there. Your thoughts on whether we should be doing more in trade?
Trade is generally a very positive thing for our economy. The issue is that it has winners and losers, and the people that are getting kicked to the curb as a result of trade deals rightfully feel like it's not working for them and their communities. So we have to figure out a way to share the bounty with the folks who are actually losing their jobs or having their opportunities reduced as a result of these trade deals. If we do that, then we should be able to enter into trade deals with a clean conscience and know that Americans are winning across the board. It's one reason why a freedom dividend is so important and vital. Because historically, when we had a trade deal that was going to eliminate lots of jobs, what we said is we're going to have a retraining program for the workers. And the workers, on some level, know those retraining programs do not work very well. And in reality, they do not work very well. So we need a different mechanism to try and protect the people that are actually going to suffer from various trade deals.
Okay, we have time for a couple of questions. And we have students here, St. A's, the microphones, so just wait. Beth?
Hi there. Good morning. His tumor was responding nicely to the chemotherapy that was prescribed for him. However, the cost of that chemotherapy was huge because he did not have the coverage to help him maintain that. He dipped into his retirement and exhausted his retirement, which certainly didn't do much for him and his family for the future. His necessity was that he had a lapse in his treatment for 2 months. His tumor flourished during that time and he's now dying. If elected president, what would you do to help lower prescription drug costs?
Thank you for sharing that story. Unfortunately, that is now a surprisingly common American story where there are millions of Americans who are making difficult choices, sometimes even tragic choices, about drugs versus savings versus, in some cases, even food and shelter. It doesn't have to be this way. Right now, we have a healthcare system that is designed to make money off of us and not make us stronger and healthier. And we're spending a lot on this system. I would move towards a Medicare for All system that provides a public plan for your middle-aged friend and all Americans to know that if you end up very, very ill, that your costs will be covered. I would not get rid of private insurance because I think private insurance has a role to play, but we need to get this crushing weight off of the backs of American families and businesses. There is no reason why your friend has to dip into retirement savings that he's saved for years to try and make himself well again. Other countries have gotten this right. We need to get it right too. But to me, right now we're in the worst of all worlds, where we're spending 18% of GDP on a healthcare system that's making us not as healthy as other developed countries. And we all live in fear of stories exactly like your friends, where there are Americans around the country that are just avoiding the healthcare system because they know if they get stuck with a bill, it's going to break their back, it's going to break their family's back. And you have to ask yourself, why are we allowing that to happen? We can fix it. I'm in the Medicare for All camp, but I would not get rid of private insurance.
Okay.
Chuck,
just wait for the mic. You don't have to stand.
So this question is based on the fact that if American productivity, if the minimum wage had kept pace with the American productivity, it would be over $19 an hour. Could you speak to why you believe that pushing for a universal basic income would be a better path than a minimum wage of $15 an hour or even a government guaranteed jobs program?
No one should be working full-time in America and be poor. And right now, our minimum wage actually has you at the poverty line in many parts of the country, functionally. The question is, how can we get buying power into Americans' hands so that no one's working full-time and poor in a way that doesn't disadvantage small businesses, many of which are just breaking even, and also recognizes the kind of work that caregivers and parents and nurturers around the country are doing, people like my wife, where if you have a higher minimum wage, it does nothing for the approximately 10 million stay-at-home moms in the United States. So a freedom dividend straight into our hands, the functional equivalent of a $6 an hour raise for everybody. So that ends up boosting the minimum wage towards the teens, and that makes it so that if you are working full-time, that you're not at the poverty line. That to me is a much more efficient way. One of the things that I'm passionate about is that I think small businesses are the backbone of economic growth and opportunity in many, many communities. And when you talk about a higher minimum wage, you are talking about small businesses that are often paying their workers $9, $10, $11 an hour, where if you were to ratchet it up to 15, they would have to make some tough choices around shifts or employment, or in some cases it might even push them below the profitability line. And so it's much more effective for us just to put buying power into the hands of American consumers. That ends up growing the small business, because then that small business is now selling to people that have more money to spend. It's a much more effective way to get buying power into our hands that actually bolsters small businesses instead of asking more and more of them.
Do we have a mic in the back here? Gentlemen, just wait, and then we'll do Fred.
Thank you for your time this morning. Appreciate it. Sounds like one of your main arguments for why we need a universal basic income is because technology is changing rapidly enough that it's taking a lot of the jobs with it. And creative destruction has always been sort of a fundamental part of the US economy. Economic liberalization leads to technological innovation. Technological innovation leads to the destruction of the transformation of industries, and jobs are destroyed as a result. In what, mid-19th century, about 75% of Americans worked on farms, and now it's less than 5%. And over that time, obviously, wealth and prosperity has dramatically improved for the average American. What's different? Why did creative destruction cause so much wealth up until now, but then starting in 2020, the trend is going to reverse, and suddenly creative destruction begins a trend where we need to rely on the government for a universal basic income?
I'm very, very pro-progress. I hope people sense that. I think that technology and innovation are tremendous things for America. But MIT, McKinsey, the Obama White House all have looked at what we're going through, this fourth industrial revolution, and they have projected that it's going to be 2 to 3 times faster and more impactful than the previous industrial revolution at the turn of the century. So that's not just me projecting. That's very, very smart people looking at it and saying between 20 and 40% of American jobs are potentially subject to automation in the next 10 to 20 years. And by the numbers, our labor market is not adapting very well to this. Our labor force participation rate is down to 63%, close to a multi-decade low, and the same levels as El Salvador and Costa Rica, as one example. Another example, interstate migration rates in the United States are at multi-decade lows, which are at the opposite of what you would expect and want if you saw that there was massive change in the economy and that people were then readjusting and in some cases moving. By the numbers, these things are not happening. by the numbers, we're looking at an industrial revolution that's going to be 2 to 3 times more pervasive and impactful than previous industrial revolution. And the previous industrial revolution included mass riots that killed dozens of Americans and caused billions of dollars worth of damage. It's one reason why we have Labor Day as a holiday today, which is in response to those riots. And we instituted universal high school in 1911, in part as a response to what was happening with the first industrial revolution. So if you expect this one to be 2 to 3 times more impactful than that one, and that one required massive social responses, then you would expect the same thing for this one, particularly because the data clearly show that the degradation is already ripping through communities around the country, and there has not been any real adjustment on the part of the labor market.
Fred Coker, and we'll just wait for the mic, Fred. Fred is the inventor of the politics in age, so.
Wow. You're the one candidate I've been waiting for to ask this question. We live in an age of the need for cybersecurity. We're, a lot of us in this room, be it small business or individually, may have been hacked already, and that's gonna get worse. What would you do?
There are two major issues. Thank you for the question, and thank you for starting this incredible series. Look at this, it's like hundreds of candidates later, thousands of eggs later. So there are two related issues here. To me, cybersecurity is one of the fundamental security threats of the 21st century. And one way we can help make progress in cybersecurity, right now, how do we all interact with cybersecurity? We give our data to a variety of tech companies. Even the lawyers among us do not read that language when they ask us to agree to something, right? You just scroll down and say, I agree. And then you hope for the best. And then periodically there's some press release saying, hey, Yahoo's passwords were hacked. And then you're like, do I have to change my password? That is the way we interact with our data right now. It's essentially we've given our data to some variety of tech companies, in some cases willingly, in some cases unknowingly, and then we don't know what happens. And what's happening right now to that data is it's getting sold and resold and repurposed, sometimes anonymously, sometimes not, to various companies, where if you give your data to a company, it might have changed hands a dozen times since. You have no idea what happened. You certainly didn't participate in that value. So one step towards adequate cybersecurity is to hold the tech companies accountable for what is happening to our data. I am the only candidate who is saying that our data is ours and it should be our property, regardless of whether we essentially loan it or lease it to these tech companies. It still should be ours. And then the onus is on the tech companies to say, okay, here's what we're doing with your data, here's whether we're profiting from it, and if you want, you can actually unplug at any time. This would raise the standard on the tech companies in terms of their responsibility to both report what they're doing and also protect our information, because then it's seen as our property. Then the second part of this is the cybersecurity itself. Right now, unfortunately, the tech companies don't have that strong a financial interest in protecting our data because we don't know what they're doing with it, and all they do is occasionally just have a press release they hope everyone ignores, which frankly we do ignore. Our government has been decades behind the curve on technology. And that's not an exaggeration. We actually got rid of the Office of Technology Assessment in 1995. So we are precisely 24 years behind the curve on technology. I guess they decided that everything had been invented by 1995. So first, we create an actual financial incentive for the tech companies to protect our data. We say it's ours. And then second, we enforce new cybersecurity regs that actually raise the standards for the companies. I've talked to tech leaders. I'm friendly with some of them. I've been endorsed by Elon Musk, Jack Dorsey, Sam Altman, Alexis Ohanian, who's better known as Serena Williams' husband. And the techies know that that things have gotten gone too far, and that in some cases they're even actually calling out for government partnership, which is unheard of in that industry, you should know. Like, it's not normal for them to be like, hey, you know what, we could actually use a little bit of government on this. But they are at that point now. And that's where they are on cybersecurity. Because the truth is, it's very hard for them to, it's very hard for them to safeguard against Russian hacking and a bunch of other things. So they're actually looking to the government for help right now. And that's what we need to provide. There's no easy answer because it's much easier to hack these systems than it is to secure them. And there's this new technology coming out right now. I hate to scare you guys. quantum computing. It's going to be a great leap forward in de-encryption and theoretically encryption, but primarily de-encryption, where just imagine a computer that can make nearly infinite calculations in a relatively short period of time, and that enables them to break almost any conventional encryption that exists right now. Google just announced that they have a quantum computer that can make these calculations. So we are entering a very, very tough phase in American life. This is before we have something called deepfakes, which are essentially videos that are indistinguishable from the original video. So there could be a video of me shaking hands with Putin or whatever. And then if you saw the video, I've never met Putin, just so you know, there's no video of that. That even if you were to forensically analyze it, you wouldn't be able to tell the fake from the real. We're entering that time in American history. And it is imperative that our government actually catch up to the problems of 2019 as quickly as possible. I believe that's what I can help accelerate.
Can I just follow up on that? What do we need to do now to prepare for a 2020 presidential election where there will be no hacking and no interference at all?
Well, it would help if we had a current administration that actually seemed to care about safeguarding us against Russian hacking. The tech companies are going to do more this time, but they tell me that there is no way that they can 100% safeguard their social networks from bots and various forms of interference. They're playing catch up. They're stamping out the obvious misinformation. My feeling about how we safeguard our democracy in 2020 is we win by such a margin that even hacking at the margins and machines in various districts will not alter the result. This past time, Donald Trump had to pull a bit of an inside straight in some states. If you had 70,000 votes go the other direction in various states, the outcome would have been different. The goal here is to run up our margin of victory by a point where some tampering at the margins doesn't hurt us. I am one of only two candidates in the field that 10% or more of Donald Trump voters say they will support in the general, which makes me perhaps the strongest candidate to beat him in 2020. And my head-to-head matchups against him, including here in New Hampshire, have me winning by 8 points or more. So that's one way we can protect ourselves against hacking, is win by so much that 1% or 2% at the margins doesn't hurt us.
Time for one or two more questions. If someone has their hand up, young lady here, just wait for the mic to come. She's coming over here.
Good morning. There's obviously been a lot in the news over the last couple of weeks regarding the situation in Syria, and I was just curious if you could detail your plans for foreign policy if you were to become president.
It's heartbreaking what's happened in Syria. We need to let our allies know that our word is good, that if we make a commitment, we're not going to abruptly change course. I've signed a pledge to end the forever wars. I do not think that Americans want our armed forces to be in a constant state of conflict for years or decades on end. And it was James Mattis, who's not exactly a dove, who's the Secretary of Defense, who said, if we invest less in diplomats, we have to buy more ammunition. The goal is to invest more in diplomacy and rebuild our partnerships and relationships abroad, let people know that we're here to stay. I think our foreign policy actually reflects how we're doing at home. The series of events was we were disintegrating at home, we elected Donald Trump, and now we're extraordinarily erratic and unreliable. The goal has to be to have the pendulum go the other direction, rebuild ourselves at home, and then project a very steady and reliable foreign policy for years to come.
Maybe one more question. Tom Cardi. Wait for the mic.
Oh, she's right there. Now, climate change is the existential threat of our time. It is, to me, hand in hand with the automation of our jobs, because in a country where 78% of Americans are living paycheck to paycheck and almost half can't afford an unexpected $400 bill, if you go to them about climate change, what do a lot of them say? I can't worry about that. I'm trying to pay my bills. The penguins will have to wait in line. So if we get the economic boot off of people's throats and reverse the mindset of scarcity that is weighing down so many Americans, we can make more rapid progress on climate change. I was in Portsmouth, and they showed me that there were dozens, hundreds of buildings that are now flooding regularly when they were not before. There was a multi-million dollar shrimping business that has gone to zero because of climate change. I staked out the new third position in American politics on climate change at the Detroit debate. I don't know if you all remember that. The first position is we have to fight climate change. The second position is climate change is a hoax. And then the new Andrew Yang third position is it's even worse than you think, and that we need to do much more to protect our communities. So I have a five-part plan that takes about 50 pages, I think, to explain on climate change, but I'll do my best to summarize some of the greatest hits. We subsidize the fossil fuel industry to the tune of hundreds of billions of dollars over the decades. And we need to take the same level of investment and move us towards sustainable renewable energy sources. So that's job number one. But America's only 15% of global emissions. The rest of the world is 85%. It does not do us that much good if we reduce our emissions and then the rest rise. And in Africa, they are firing up new coal-burning plants that China has so generously given to them. They've come and said, China's come and said, hey, would you like this plant? It burns coal. And Africa's like, yes, I'd love it. And so the challenge for us is to make renewable source of energy more competitive for developing countries so that they forego the coal-burning plants and move towards renewables as quickly as possible. We have to reverse some of the damage that we've already done. It's not just about emitting less. We actually have to proactively reforest tracts of land and try and reseed the Atlantic Ocean in particular. The Atlantic Ocean is losing 4 to 8% of its biomass every year now, which is one reason why that shrimping business went to zero. We have to proactively start trying to reseed ocean beds with plant life that will then rebuild some of the marine ecosystems. I would invest hundreds of billions in making our communities more resilient, more future-proof. That part of the plan is called Move People to Higher Ground, which sounds very dramatic, but the truth is there are already climate refugees in this country. We already moved a town in Louisiana that was uninhabitable because of rising water levels. So we need to try and provide incentives and shift our resources so that people are in environments that are protected over the long term. We all know when there's a natural disaster, who suffers the most? The poor, people of color, people that don't have cars they can get into and drive to safety, or they don't have adequate shelter. So moving people to higher ground includes a dividend of $1,000 a month, which would go very, very far towards helping the poorest among us actually be able to protect themselves as our climate gets worse. And then the fifth part of this, believe it or not, there was a list of four in there, and then the fifth is a constitutional amendment that includes safeguarding our environment so that it's an intrinsic part of the government's responsibility for generations to come.
Well, with that, I want to thank Andrew for being here today and answering the questions and give us an update.
Thank you very much.
Hello. Okay.